Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you are in the know. You can find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm David Kennedy, Professor of History Emeritus and co-director of the Bill Lane Center for the American West at Stanford University, and your moderator for this program. And tonight's program is being held in association with the California Historical Society. And it's now my pleasure to introduce our distinguished guest, Richard White, also professor of history at Stanford University and co-director at the Bill Lane Center for the American West with me, and the author of the new book, Railroaded, the Transcontinentals, and the Making of Modern America. Richard is, to be more precise, the Margaret Byrne Professor of History at Stanford, where he has been since 1998. He previously taught, among other places, at the University of Utah and the University of Washington, where he took his PhD. My wonderful colleague, Richard White, is widely regarded as a leading, one might well say, the leading scholar in three distinct but related fields: the history of the American West, environmental history, a subset of our discipline that he helped to pioneer, and Native American history. He has been the recipient of a MacArthur Genius Award, and he is the author of several notable works, including a book entitled It's Your Misfortune and None of My Own, published in 1991, a general sweeping comprehensive history of the American West, a book entitled The Middle Ground, Indians, Empires, and Republics in the Great Lakes Region, 1650 to 1815, also published in 1991. And one of my favorites as a native Pacific Northwesterner, The Organic Machine, The Remaking of the Columbia River, published in 1996. And now we have his new book, Railroaded, The Transcontinentals and the Making of Modern America. The book has already been reviewed in the Boston Globe just this last weekend, where it was described as a scathing and wonderful new book. And I think the full implications of the scathing part, as well as the wonderful, are likely to be clear as we proceed with this discussion. I should probably note at the outset that the book is not the classic story about building the transcontinental railroads, a story that's been told many times and very ably, in fact. Richard's story essentially begins when the railroads are virtually finished, and his history is really a history of how they were operated in the first 30 years or so of their existence in the last decades of the 19th century. So it's important to keep that in mind, I think, that this is not another epic saga of building the road, but how the several transcontinental lines were actually operated. So, Richard, you've entered a field of study here that others have been in before you, I think, especially of the work of Alfred D. Chandler and Robert Fogel, names that might not be familiar to this audience but are familiar to historians who have studied the railroads as the precursors of the modern American economy and the modern corporation. Your view is a little different, and I hope we'll get to that, the differences you have with Fogel and Chandler and others. But to begin, maybe you could say something about how, given your very large corpus of work on issues having to do with the West and with Native Americans and the Columbia River and so on, how did your interest in railroads grow out of your previous scholarly work, or maybe it grew out of some other source altogether?
No, the book comes after a book I actually wrote about my mother, which is about history and memory. And I wanted to get back to the American West. And what I wanted was a subject which would allow me to look at the entire late 19th, early 20th century West around a single theme. And also at the time, I wondered why historians, unless they were business historians, did not write about corporations. And so corporations, the entire West, I turned to railroads. And the next step was fairly easy. I thought, well, I'll start looking at the railroads. But once I looked at them, I realized, well, there are railroads in Canada and railroads in Mexico, which are very similar. So the book became Mexico, Canada, and the United States. And initially, I thought this is going to be pretty easy. It'll just be comparative. I'll just look at how they operate and see the differences between countries. And what I found out is it's one big railroad. My guys are the same guys, whether they're in Mexico, whether they're in Canada, whether they're in the United States. Capital for all the roads comes from the same place. The technology from all the roads come from the same place. the roads were operated really as an interlocked system. So at that point, as is usual in my books, I realized that I did not know what I was talking about, and the book became very different from the one I set out to write. As I'll talk about later with David, I started out thinking that these are going to be powerful, efficient corporations. What I'm going to be seeing is the birth of modernity in the North American West, where you don't really expect to see it. And I did find the birth of modernity in the North American West. It's just not the modernity I expected to find. My modernity has as much to do with failure as it does with success.
You one way to read your book, at least in my view, is you conduct a kind of running argument with the great Austrian-born, longtime Harvard economist, Joseph Schumpeter, who is most well-known, I suppose, for the phrase that creative destruction, that the history of capitalism, the history of the modern economies is all about creative destruction. And he, as I read it at least, is one of your principal foils as you advance your own argument. So you want to just tell us a little bit about your regard for Schumpeter and the way you've taken him on?
Well, first of all, I admire Schumpeter a great deal. What I do see is creative destruction taking place all over the West. I mean, it was Schumpeter's great insight that what capitalism does is it's always a revolutionary system in that it always has to destroy the old to bring in the new. And Schumpeter was perfectly right in seeing that going on in the way corporations operate in the late 19th century. Where I began to differ is that in Schumpeter's account, things always turn out well. Entrepreneurs always, in fact, if they fail, they're just eliminated. And if they succeed, they're de facto bringing in a new world. Well, my entrepreneurs fail and bring in a new world. And they also fail and make a whole lot of money. And that became the puzzle for me as I went on. I mean, I agreed with Schumpeter, but I didn't see the same results coming out of it, and I really wanted to understand why, how this process really worked, why virtually every railroad I looked at ended up going bankrupt. Many of them go bankrupt not once, but twice. Some of the high achievers go bankrupt three times in the spirit of 10 years. They're widely hated, and they cause all kinds of political, social, and environmental problems. Yet the men who run them grow immensely wealthy. And that became a puzzle for me. That became, in a sense, the central puzzle of the book. How exactly does this system work? Because for Schumpeter, if you fail, you're supposed to bear the burdens of your failures. My guys failed by any usual measure, but they did very well for themselves. And that's a stream that runs throughout the whole book. What I end up doing in a phrase that probably won't go very far, but it might, is it's about growth, but this is really dumb growth. This is growth where all kinds of things happen that probably would have been better if they didn't happen. And sometimes what I had the sense is I wasn't working in the North American West, I was watching a Soviet 20-year plan or something, where it's not that it doesn't do things, but in the hindsight, it just did not seem a very good idea to have done it.
You say not only is the net result of all this activity dumb growth, but in the same sentence, I believe you add the term environmental catastrophe. You want to say something about the second part of that indictment?
Yeah. What I started to do is I started to try to isolate things that would not have happened, at least the way they did, without the building of transcontinental railroads. And I'll talk a little bit about the distinction I make about transcontinentals. And the place I looked, it's easiest to look at, is the Great Plains. Well, what happens in the Great Plains between the 1860s, when the first roads penetrated, and the 1890s? Well, the first thing is the demise of the bison herds, which simply, it's not that the railroads are fully responsible for the demise of the bison herds, but the final hunt is a result of railroad building, because you could not get those hides out without railroad trains. So the railroads unintentionally bring about the near extinction of bison. Doesn't bother people very much at the time because they're going to replace them with cattle. And all kinds of cattle do go in. And cattle thrives for a while. It'll thrive until the 1870s, 1880s. And then you have a series of catastrophic winters on plains which are heavily overgrazed. And you get the virtual collapse of the cattle industry almost overnight. Bankruptcies and even ranchers, hardened ranchers, who said they never wanted to look at another cow again after they'd seen the results of those winters. After that, what you get is wheat farmers coming in. And it's not that wheat farmers don't have some good years, but the problem for wheat farmers as they move on the plains, good years, bad years, it's equally catastrophic because by this time, they're dumping large amounts of wheat onto a market for which there's no market for wheat, the price is falling, and then when drought comes, particularly on the Great Plains, many of them are busted. So what you look at is the railroads do bring development. First of all, on the small scale, the bison herds. Then you have it with the cattle industry. Then you have it with wheat farming. And all of them end by the 1890s in catastrophe, environmental damage, and political turmoil.
Now, there's another, of course, another native or indigenous population on the plains and westward of the plains that's also impacted by the railroads. And, of course, I'm referring to Native Americans, something I know you're talking about next week at the Presidio at another occasion. But I wonder if you might give us a little preview of what you're going to say then and just summarize your views about what the Transcontinental Lines did to the Native American populations.
I have to be very careful when I say this, because what I will say, though I might have to retreat a little bit on it, is railroads were probably the worst thing that happened to Indian peoples in the far west, the Great Plains, through the Great Basin, through the far west. But I hesitate to that because so many bad things happened to them that it's really hard to single out the railroads. But what I'm talking about is if you look at how American population moves, it takes Americans, if we start at Jamestown, about 2.5 centuries to get a little more than halfway across the continent. By the Civil War, they're, for all practical purposes, just beyond the Missouri River. It'll take a generation to move the rest of the way. So what you have for Indian peoples in the West, there is no time to adjust. Everything happens virtually overnight. The railroads, in a space of a few years, manage to end the treaty system. They corrupt the treaty system, which is corrupt enough to begin with, but finally they corrupt it in such a way that Congress abrogates the treaty system in 1871. We still have agreements after that. The railroads also have a problem. The transcontinentals get their subsidies for two reasons. The first reason is they have to secure California for the Union. The problem with that is the Civil War is over in 1865, and they haven't really started building the railroads in 1865, so you don't really can't use the Civil War as an excuse. What's substituted is the railroads are the way to subjugate Indians. And in fact, they are. That's perfectly true. The railroads do bring about very rapid subjugation of Indians by the ability to move troops. But my argument would be, without the railroads, there would have been no need to fight those wars to begin with. The settlement would have taken place much more gradually. And I think in the end, much of the American West would look a lot more like the Navajo Reservation than it would look like the Pine Ridge Reservation. That the kinds of developments that take place very quickly could have been postponed, and in fact, it would have cost the United States little. It would have gained the Indians much. What I'm not arguing is, of course, in the end, Indians are going to become subjugated by the United States. I'm talking about when and where it happens, the speed and how it happens.
One of the audience asked the question, your description of railroads feeling as owners profit sounds very similar to recent bank failures as owners profited. Do you agree? Let me just expand on the question a little bit by sharing with the audience here a passage from your book where you offer a kind of summary judgment of what the story is that you've been telling. And here's your characterization of the railroads at the end of the day. Overbuilt, prone to bankruptcy and receivership, wretchedly managed, politically corrupt, environmentally harmful, and financially wasteful, these corporations nonetheless helped create a world where private success often came from luck, fortunate timing, and state intervention. Profit arose more from financial markets and insider contracts than from successfully selling transportation. Now, before you answer, I just want to remind you of the subtitle of your book, and I think this underlies the question that I read from the audience, that you're talking about the Transcontinentals here as some kind of precursors of modern America. There's some kind of harbinger of modernity in your story. So is it a fact that it was the observation of the current economic and financial scene that was part of your motivation for writing?
Well, this book took 12 years. Many of the disasters that seem so parallel to this had not taken place when I was writing this book. And the other thing is, you know, odd as it may sound, and I think David will come back to it later, I became fond of some of these guys, though it doesn't sound like it from that passage. But I wrote this in two places. I wrote it in Seattle, where I started the book, and then I wrote it in Palo Alto. I wrote it when the beginnings of things like Enron, the dot-com bust, then finally the financial crisis, which comes towards the end of the book. And I began to realize there were certain parallels, because I started this, I have a great admiration for business history, and I've learned a lot about it from business historians. But I had a very naive idea that the way people made money from corporations is the corporations made money selling something, and then they divided it up among the stockholders. But I had a whole bunch of corporations that lost money. The stockholders very often got very little, and yet the people who had control of the corporation made vast fortunes. And so I began to see, especially among the dot-coms, when all of those companies which seemed to sell nothing, and I was trying to buy a house at the same time in the Silicon Valley, and I knew that anybody who walked in with a stake in one of those companies, every time I saw anybody who was under 30, I just walked out. I couldn't compete with them. I could not buy a house. But they were making huge amounts of money, and then all of those companies tank. The financial crisis was the same thing. It's an utter catastrophe. They have to be bailed out. But the bankers themselves suffer very little. They actually do quite well. And I began to think, well, this isn't just something that's the late 20th century. In a weird way, the late 20th century and the early 21st century seem to be a lot like the 19th century. Everything seemed to be like the 19th century. And the danger is for a historian is all my antennae go up then. Because I write about the past. People who lived there were not like us. And in many ways, there are differences. But clearly, the kinds of structural things, the kind of modernity that we're used to, was already beginning to emerge with the first corporations in the American West as it's first being settled, and all the kinds of entanglements with Washington, all the kinds of financial markets, all the kinds of chicanery that we became all too familiar with. You know, these guys were doing it a little simpler, but they were doing much the same thing.
This, I want to ask a question that maybe takes you a little bit, or maybe quite a little bit, beyond the boundaries of your own book, your research and writing. But there is a lot of history that intervenes between the late 19th century and now. And though our own age may have some similarities to this, a lot of things have intervened. For example, the creation of the Interstate Commerce Commission in the 1880s to try to bring some order to the railroad industry through federal government regulation, and a series of other government initiatives to bring order to various marketplaces over the course of the late 19th and through the 20th century. The New Deal be one great moment when a lot of those things come into being. So what's their story? Did they correct some of the evils and the problems that you see in the 19th century and now we've let our guard down again? Or is it one continuous story of corruption and malfeasance from the 1860s forward?
No, you've caught on to the problem with that, is that just because the late 20th century and the late 19th century are similar, that doesn't mean everything in between was similar. And one of the things I noticed, and there's a chart in the book, and it comes from an English economic historian. What he did is start to calculate per capita income. So I went into the railroads thinking, well, say what you will, which is the usual way it's phrased. Say what you will about the late 19th century. There were rising standards of living all over the United States. Well, actually, there weren't. And indeed, in the West, they were dropping. They dropped between 1870, 1880, 1880, 1890. They dropped until 1900. And the progressives, who, if any of you follow this literature, professional historians have been really hard on, we probably should let up a bit, because that's when per capita incomes for individuals in the United States really start to rise. And they will continue to rise all the way through, as David says, the New Deal, World War II, the 1950s, 1960s, 1970s, and they stagnate when we begin to get the kinds of things that I'm seeing here. So there is a long interlude. I mean, one of the things that I say about this book, most of the reviews so far have stressed the critical elements of it, but one of the things I try to bring out is the Gilded Age, the late 19th century, was also an age of reform. And in the 20th century, many of those reforms worked. It's not that these things are unmanageable. It's not that people can't take some control over them. And so I really do, You know, I'm not a happy face historian. I never will be. It's not going to happen, but I really do try to point out, for all the limits of reform in the late 19th century, it does achieve many things which show up in the 20th century. And people ignore the fact that the roots of so many of these things are in the late 19th century, and so many of them come out of opposition to the railroads.
So, Richard, someone in the audience asked the following question. What was the biggest challenge you encountered in researching this book? In other words, when did you know you had to stop doing research? I assume you could have continued for years. And in the course of your response to that, you might want to tell us a little something about your own research and writing habits. Do you write at night or in the morning or the middle of the day? Or do you have research assistants and so on?
Usually I don't use research assistants, and I owe virtually all my writing habits to my children when they were small. The only time I could ever write was to get up very early in the morning before they were up. And I set a pattern of just writing very early in the morning, then helping get the kids ready for school, then teaching all day. Late at night, I'm not much good. I can read, but I really can't write. So much of the book will be written in those sort of pre-dawn hours, which I've become very, very fond of. I mean, it's a habit which is largely due to my children, but it's one that served me very, very well. I owe them a great debt of gratitude, though. I guess I've never expressed it to them that way. And so that became the habit. And what I do, I mean, for this book, I operate differently from many historians. Many historians will go out and read all the secondary literature. Well, I've taught the late 19th century, so I know a lot of it, but I did not read the secondary literature first. I go into the archives. What I really want to do is get to know people. I mean, I can say this to David or to any other historians in the audience, and they'd know what I mean. Otherwise, it seems kind of strange. The people I write about are more real to me than most of the people I see on the streets every day. This is something that scares my wife. She's gotten used to it after all these years, but it really is true. And what you begin to do when you know them, is when you get to a situation and you can predict what they're going to do, and they do it. And at that point, you think, okay, I really have reached some kind of understanding. And much of the research I do is technical, it's around railroad issues, but the core piece of research is I read other people's mail. I mean, that's what I do. And in the 19th century, the thing I liked about these guys is I really came to respect the business letter. It's to the point. It's not long. It has to be pithy. It goes right there. And the other thing is, I can't call my guys honest, but I would call them frank. And they say things that I couldn't believe they were saying till I come to the bottom of the letter, and it says, destroy this letter, burn this letter. It tells you a lot about the 19th century that there's so many items in the archive that clearly are unburned and undestroyed. The people are so trusting in a way that it's hard for me to believe. I mean, thank God they didn't have Twitter, I think, in the 19th century for this stuff to go out, but they leave it for me to read. And so when the things about that I say are scathing, mostly what I do is quote them, what they say about each other. They really do come to dislike each other a great deal, and they're quite perceptive about why they dislike each other. But then I had to organize it by corporations, and the place I stop, because for all historians, you can literally go on forever. When the yield of anything new really began to diminish. At that point, it was time to stop reading, because I could go on forever. And 12 years is a long, long time.
This is, I must say, a prodigiously deeply researched book. The archival research that underlies the narrative is truly phenomenal. I dare say very, very admirable. Richard, you refer to these the principles that appear in your story as my guys, and you had a kind of a grudging fondness for them. But when you touch on them, you enter into this very, very controversial area of corruption and how corrupt they were. I'm reminded of some things that Mark Twain said, perhaps in that famous novel he did with Charles Dudley Warner, The Gilded Age, which gave the name to the era. But someplace, maybe there or elsewhere, he said, America has no native criminal class except for the United States Congress. And I think another one was, I once met a congressman who was an SOB, but why do I repeat myself? and there's more than a little of that flavor in your book. So maybe we want to say a little something about what you mean by corruption, a word that appears, if not on every page, certainly with high frequency in your account. Twain's notion of corruption, I think, was mostly corruption of the body politic, that politicians were for sale. The definition of an honest congressman was one who, when he was bought, he would stay bought. So it was the corruption of the political realm in particular that bothered him. You have some of that on your mind, but as I read you, you have an even broader definition of corruption. Do you want to say something about the nature of corruption in late 19th century America?
It's quite complicated. I'll start simply and add a few of the complications. What I mean by corruption basically is something very, very simple, but I branched out from there. I meant any exchange of public goods for private favors. And that became the kind of thing that wanted. Railroads would do favors for congressmen, and congressmen would grant them charters, grant them subsidies, grant them laws that help them against rivals, all of these things. So essentially it's taking, this is what Americans most feared in the 19th century. This is still, in the years after the Civil War, there's still a Jacksonian element. And they thought the republic is going to fall because, in fact, private interests are going to take over from public good. And the corporation, as they saw it, was going to be the thing that was the engine that drove all of this. Now, that does happen. What I argue in the book is something more subtle really happened, is the corporation wasn't interested in running the United States. The corporation wasn't interested in taking over politics. All these guys wanted to do was make some money. And so they really had limited ambitions, and to make money, they really had to make sure, and this is, I think, one of the central insights, at least for me in the book, is they turned politics into a way that businesses compete, that goes on to the present day. When one business wants to stop another business, and you can see it now, the quarrel between the banks, for example, would be an easy one, and retail merchants. Both of them are fighting in Congress for business advantage. That's what the railroads do. And to do that, everybody had, and it's a word that became, it's in many of my books, I read for a couple of years and then I go, that's what they mean. The word was friends. Everybody here was friend. It was friend Huntington, friend Stanford, friend Hopkins, friend Crocker. I mean, it sounds like a Quaker meeting a lot of the time to read the correspondence. But when you know that they don't like each other, then you begin to get it, well, friendship means something else. What they do is keep friendship as a social form. They drain it of all affection. Hatred is personal. Friendship's business. And that's what they do with these guys. So what you have is a series of commitment, and when the Mark Twain quote, an honest congressman is somebody who, when he's bought, stays bought, friendship is about loyalty. Friendship is about trust. And it might be in a bad cause, but many of them, remember, are union veterans who run the railroads, and the worst thing you can say about somebody is they're a traitor. The worst thing is treason. And for them, they carry over that kind of ethics, which had once been ennobled to save the union, into business relationships, and that's how the whole thing operates. They have friends who are newspapermen. They have friends who are politicians. They have friends who are judges. They have friends who are other businessmen. They have friends who are bankers. But if you want to understand the late 19th century, it's friendship. And they don't bribe each other. Bribery is a failure of friendship. To bribe somebody, it's an ad hoc purchase, and you can't count on it. What a friend does is have reciprocal interests. A friend can be counted on and know they'll be rewarded later. And that's how this kind of intersection of business and politics comes about. These guys will serve a year or two in Congress, and this sounds familiar again. They become lobbyists. They become corporate employees. They become lawyers for the corporation. They move back and forth. They get payoffs that they're taken care of. But to have to bribe somebody, that raises the whole issue of the corruption of the government itself. It makes everything far too visible. It's far too messy. It's not that they won't do it. They do it, but they like to avoid it.
I'd just like to remind our radio audience that you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest today is Richard White, a professor of history at Stanford University and co-director at the Bill Lane Center for the American West at Stanford, and we're here discussing his new book, Railroaded, and discussing myths about the Transcontinental Railroads and the building of the American West. Richard, we've got more than one question here that I suppose you have anticipated about the founder of our university. So one questioner says, Leland Stanford was the founder of the university that presumably pays your salary as well as that of the moderator, that's me. Don't you have anything positive to say about the so-called robber barons? And in the same vein, another questioner asks, given your position with Stanford, this may be a difficult question, but how corrupt was Leland Stanford?
Okay. First of all, you know, as my wife said, one of the things, sometimes she does things she's going to put on my gravestone, and one of them is he bites the hands that fed him. and that's fair enough. But Leland Stanford, let me give you a piece of advice, which probably most of you know already. Do not destroy your personal papers. If you destroy your personal papers, your side of everything that happens is pretty much going to be lost, while all those other letters, which you might have marked destroy when read, are resting very safely in Collis P. Huntington's archives and all kinds of people who hate you. So most of you, there's an abundant Stanford correspondence, which does show that he is quite corrupt. But there's nothing else giving Stanford's side of the story, because it's unclear who, but almost certainly Jane Stanford, destroyed all of Leland's correspondence. So what's left is the letters he wrote to other people. And they are abundant, and they are damning, and there's testimony that he gave. So he is very much part of it, because one of the things that happens is the people who ran the Central Pacific were known as the associates. They were in it together. Things became so messy, and they all had so much to hide that nobody could ever back out of this corporation. The only way you got out of the Southern Pacific is you died. People tried. It was sort of like the mafia. They came back. You had to come back in. And for a while, I thought, well, that's because they're never going to steal from each other. But that left out David Colton. There's a famous 19th century trial of David Colton. It's actually wonderful, because the day they captured Black Bart, the last stagecoach robber in California, is the day that the Colton trial started. So if you go back to the San Francisco papers, you'll have, first of all, the account of Black Bart, the stage robber who used to leave bad poetry with his victims. And then you have the opening of the Colton trial, which became the most famous trial in late 19th century California. David Colton was an associate who was stealing from the other associates. When he died, the associates figured out that he'd embezzled from them. They went to his widow and stole it back. In doing this, they also found out that because the books were so cooked, it was very easy for their employees to steal from them. They found out their bookkeeper had stolen $600,000. So there's all kinds of theft and corruption up and down. But by and large, the associates themselves came to dislike each other, but they stuck together all the time. And Stanford is one of them. The real person who runs the Southern Pacific is Collis P. Huntington. And Huntington is corrupt, but he's also funny, tough, mean. He's, of all the people I've sort of read doing historical stuff, I would hesitate to go up against him. It doesn't mean that you're going to lose a fight to Huntington, but you're probably not going to win it, and you're almost certainly going to wish you were never in that fight to begin with. So he's a very formidable character, much more so than Stanford.
The questioner asked about the robber barons. That the term robber barons, as I understand it, was put into common circulation as the title of a book by Matthew Josephson, published in the 1930s, and that book is very redolent of the extremely anti-business, anti-corporate sentiment of that Great Depression decade. I just want to go through a list of some of the people who I suppose qualify as robber barons or their lackeys and acolytes that you write about. And then I want to ask you a question about the robber baron interpretation of history. But there's about a half dozen or more people here, and I'm quoting your characterizations of them, all right? You say of Thomas Durant that he was a buffoon. John Murray Forbes was narrow-minded. Silas Seymour was corrupt and largely incompetent. James Harvey Strobridge was a racist, brutal misanthrope. Grenville Dodge was a liar and an eclectic hater who hated loudly and demonstratively. Sam Brannan was a buffoon, another one. Oakes Ames was curt, belligerent, and obtuse. and the gaggle of Southern Pacific executives, a whole bunch of them that you name, were a divided, quarrelsome, petulant, arrogant, and inept men. That sounds a little bit, more than a little bit, like Matthew Josephson, and yet you say in your introduction that you think the robber baron interpretation of history is likely to be the most likely misinterpretation of what you've tried to argue. So given that that tone and the way you deal with individual robber barons, how is it that your account really is distinguishable in its analytic core from Matthew Josephson's account and the whole robber baron theory?
Okay, I think one of the things that happens after 10 or 12 years of reading their correspondence, much of that is paraphrasing what they said about each other. I mean, I'll give you a taste. I'll give you one quote of it. It was the golden age of American vitriol. So when I quote something, I often think, well, this is actually pretty mild compared to what they're saying about each other. But A.A. Cohen, who is a San Francisco businessman involved off and on with the Southern Pacific, said about Charles Crocker, let me see if I can get this right, he was a living, breathing, waddling monument to viciousness, vulgarity, and dishonesty. Okay, I'm up against masters here. Compared to the kinds of things they said, what I say is quite mild. So many of the things I do say, Thomas Durant, that is probably the nicest thing that anybody ever said about him. So I do say them, but I'm reflecting pretty much the sources that I had. But they're not robber barons. And the two books that probably dominate most about our vision of what these railroad corporations were like were Josephson's, at least in popular literature, Josephson's book, and also, of course, Frank Norris's The Octopus. My main difference is my guys weren't nearly as competent. I mean, I think what you tend to have is you look in the outside of these corporations, and they seem to be so dominant. They seem to have an idea of what they want to achieve, and they go ahead and achieve it. They might be evil and rotten and corrupt, but they're certainly capable, and there really seems to be no resisting them. You go inside these corporations, as I say at one time, it's four fat guys in an octopus suit, and they're fighting over the control of the engine. I mean, it really is, when Chandler, who does the Visible Hand, he looks at board records. I'm looking at what the presidents say, what the vice presidents say, what the managers say, and what the workers say. All of us know that's a very different view of an organization. And when you go into the bowels of these organizations, poor Charles Francis Adams, who's one of the main characters in the book, he could not contain himself about the ineffectiveness, inefficiency of the Union Pacific, and what it turned into with him is utter self-loathing. That he was actually the head of this corporation that he could never, despite sacrificing many years of his life to, could get to work. So I think my difference is they're not as competent. And that goes back to my central problem. And all this goes back in many ways to a conversation I had with my father when I must have been 10 or 11 years old. My father was a businessman. He was a vice president at the time. And, probably he was working in the equivalent of an organization like this. I was just eating my breakfast, I didn't know what he was talking about. And he said, I want you to tell me something. I want you to tell me how when you go to work in the day, and nobody can do their job, nobody knows what they're doing, nobody can give you an accurate piece of information, you cannot find an honest man, how is it that the world works, that the sun is going to set, the sun is going to rise, and we're going to do it all again tomorrow? I thought he was talking about me, because I was 10. But it's also one of those questions that once asked lingered someplace in the back of my mind. And it became the mystery of how corporations work. I mean, they're dysfunctional, totally dysfunctional, the ones I'm looking at. But they function. They go on. They'll collapse in a heap. They'll be brought back, put back together by the courts and the federal government, and off they'll go again, collapse in a heap again. This is how this world begins to work. And that became the puzzle I really was trying to figure out. It's very different than the kinds of either managerial corporations, the triumphant entrepreneur, or anybody like the octopus, or robber barons. It's not the way it works. And my account of it largely comes from them, because the number of men in the 19th century who are on the verge of a nervous breakdown is unbelievable. I mean, there's a wonderful moment in the panic of 1873 where Collis P. Huntington, who is about as tough an individual as I've ever encountered, as I said, Huntington sits in his office and says, I sit here going nowhere, not knowing what to do. And he writes at another time that he has slept maybe 3 hours in the last week. And this is the kind of thing that happens. They literally feel overwhelmed by a system they're both creating, but which clearly is not under their control. And that's the problem with the robber barons. The robber barons are in control. I can't find the people who are in control running the corporations that I look at. And I'm talking about the Transcontinentals. I'm not talking about other railroads. I'm a historian. I have an evidentiary base that will keep to that evidentiary base, not necessarily universalize it to all other corporations.
So you're, part of what you're doing, and I think very successfully in the book, is demythologizing this inherited notion of these supreme potentates known as robber barons, that they really weren't, they might have had a baronial lifestyle, but they didn't have baronial power, even over their own corporations. So there's a lot of demythologizing going on here. But on close reading, among the people that you're demythologizing, as it were, or people who bought the mythological line even at the time, were people like Frank Norris and The Octopus, a book that so many California students have read over generations, and people elsewhere too. And even, it would appear, one of California's most famous governors, Hiram Johnson, who made his political career by taking on The Octopus, the Southern Pacific Railroad. Much of the political system that we have in this state today, not least of all the initiative and the referendum and the recall, are the direct product of his attack on the Southern Pacific Railroad. But by your account, by Hiram Johnson's day, 1910, 1911, The Octopus was, as you say, an empty suit. There really was no true power there. So how can contemporaries like Norris and Johnson have got it so wrong?
Because what there's a brief window. There's a window between 1882 and probably it's about 1884 to 1892 is a better date, in which there really is an octopus, where there is a political machine. And it's, you know, San Francisco still is, but it really was a colorful city in the 19th century. But what Leland Stanford does is hook up with a guy who's the blind boss, Chris Buckley. And Chris Buckley's a Democrat, Stanford's a Republican. And what they do is essentially run the state for Boodle. Stanford is elected senator. He buys the election. It's very clear at the time. And then George Hearst buys the election. And that's very clear at the time. So there's a period where, in fact, there's building up this reform wave against the octopus. The octopus, by 1892, when Stanford and Huntington start quarreling, is this utterly divided machine. Chris Buckley, the guys he trained far too well. They convene a grand jury. He decides he's suffering poor health, and he goes to London. Even though the grand jury indictments of him are illegal, they're thrown out in court, he sees the writing on the wall. He's done. Stanford, Huntington comes to Stanford and says, here's the evidence that you bought the Senate seat. Here's what I want you to do. We'll send you back to the Senate. You resign as president of the Southern Pacific Railroad. You can keep the Central Pacific. Stanford takes the deal. Huntington takes it over, says he's getting the Southern Pacific out of politics, but he's not getting it out of politics. Instead, what you have is the Southern Pacific will be running three different candidates representing three different factions of the Southern Pacific. And what they achieve in 1892 is the miraculous. They allow somebody named Stephen White, no relation to me, to become a Democratic anti-monopolist senator from California. And it's really White far more than Hiram Johnson. Hiram Johnson's father actually worked for the Southern Pacific. He's one of the congressmen who's in their pocket. He breaks the power. But there's this memory of those 8 years that is really quite real. And that's what goes on with Norris. Norris uses that. And I think for Johnson, it'd be very interesting to go back and look at Johnson. My sense is, though I can't prove it because I stopped the book before that, is Hiram Johnson is a really smart politician. The octopus is far too valuable to throw away. I mean, everybody has the memory of it. They might not know it's really as powerful anymore. But he turns it into something that he can just whip back and forth up and down the state. Harriman comes in, takes over the Southern Pacific. He's not the political operator that he is. He's no match for Johnson. And I think what Johnson will do is steal the railroad issue from the Democrats, make it a progressive Republican one, but put in an awful lot of reforms. But the octopus, in its classic form, is dead by the early 1890s.
You've pretty thoroughly demythologized the railroads, the Transcontinentals, as the all-powerful entities that many people thought they were. But what if we broaden the terms of that that point and ask, just generally speaking, what, if anything at all, is left of the broader myths of the American West, cowboys, sodbusters, homesteaders, the Oregon trekker, and California trail trekkers, and so on. Is there anything of that mythic history that's still defensible on historical standards? Or is the whole thing is to be put into the fabled dustbin?
Well, I mean, any set of stories that can have the power that those stories have, my feeling as a historian, it makes no difference if they're true or not. They become their own truths. What happens here is people themselves really begin to live according to these kinds of mythic strictures. And so what you'll have is, I mean, this wonderful account which Patty Limerick and others have used, I've used it too, and it sort of captures the way this works. It's Kit Carson comes to rescue a woman who has been captured by, I think, the Cheyennes. He's too late. In fact, what they do is they kill their prisoners and ride away. And in going through the stuff that's been captured there, he begins going through the debris in the camp, and he finds a dime novel. And the dime novel is about Kit Carson rescuing women from the Apaches. And Kit Carson sits down and starts reading the dime novel. And Kit Carson is upset because in the novel, he saved the women. This time, he lost the women. So what Kit Carson begins to realize is that here's an actual historical character now constructing himself out of these kinds of myths. Buffalo Bill Cody, who I think is the great genius the American West produced, is the one who understood this. What he understood is the West itself could become a commodity. Buffalo Bill's Wild West show, which never calls itself a show, will take the actual people who are involved. I mean, what you have in Buffalo Bill's Wild West show is Indians who had fought Custer will then join Buffalo Bill's Wild West show to fight Custer on stage and in the arena. And before Wounded Knee, which Buffalo Bill will go out and scout for the army, Indians in Buffalo Bill's Wild West show are some of the Indians who fight at Wounded Knee. You know, at this point, who can tell the reality and the fiction? It just goes back and forth. So my larger point about the West is, yeah, you can demythologize the West all you want. You will never get at the heart of these stories. These stories are really about not so much the West, they're about America. They're about this sense that you can reimagine yourself, you can begin again, that there's a place, in fact, that you can go which is untouched. All of this is utterly mythical, but a place that's untouched where you can be the first person there. All of these things play very deeply into the American psyche. It's no wonder that, you know, when we talk about genres, there's a Western, there's no Southern, there's no Midwestern. It begins to encapsulate this whole set of hopes. So what I do, I love Westerns. And the last thing I ever want to do, I don't want to go see True Grit and go, ah. You know, it's wonderful. I mean, it really does capture something. Does it capture what it was like in Indian Territory in the 1880s? Well, probably not. But it's really after a much larger game than that.
As you well know, one of the great iconic Western films, The Man Who Shot Liberty Valance, yep. Probably the single most memorable line from that film comes at the very end, where the newspaper man, I believe it is, says, "When the truth becomes legend, print the legend."
Right.
And the West has been an engine of driving these myths of legendary proportions, no doubt about it.
Yeah, historians like me aren't going to touch that.
There's at least one, I'm going to call him robber baron, who at least at first glance appears to be an outlier in your set of villains, and that's James J. Hill. Who built the Great Northern Railroad, which, at least by popular understanding, is the one of the four, I believe, major transcontinentals that was built largely without federal subsidy. And it's the northernmost of the U.S. transcontinentals. I believe Hill once said something to the effect that any man who lives where the snow don't fall ain't worth a tinker's dam, because he was trying to populate the regions along his line. But you've given me to understand that maybe I've misunderstood Hill, that he should not be admired as the one person who did it as a solely private enterprise, that there was plenty of opportunity for interface with the political system and the standard kind of corruption there as well.
Yeah, now Hill is a little more complicated. I mean, Hill's most famous quote is, I think, give me enough Swedes and whiskey and I'll build you a railroad to hell. but what Hill had is Hill is the only one who realizes, though he's a little bit ahead, he foresees, in fact, he's going to build a railroad which has something to put on it. That's the major problem with the Transcontinentals. He's a little early. He doesn't anticipate the Depression of 1893. But it's not true that he doesn't get a subsidy. Hill's core road around the Great Northern is the St. Paul, Minneapolis, and Manitoba, which has some of the largest land grants in Minnesota and the Dakotas, and very valuable land. That becomes the core around which he extends that road into the Great Northern. But the real thing that Hill does is Hill builds a road at about the time where, for the first time, you really need transcontinentals. Because in 1890, after the Depression of 1893, the American economy takes off. For the first time, there's traffic for these roads. The single fact that struck me about the problems before that are the United States government subsidizes transcontinental railroads. Transcontinental railroads build to California. The transcontinental railroads will then take part of the money that they get and pay a subsidy to steamship lines to raise their rates back east. And the reason is they cannot compete with the steamship lines for freight. So during this whole time, the government has paid a subsidy to a corporation who subsidizes another corporation so that everybody can raise rates so that, they, in fact, you can make some money transferring goods across the country. Otherwise, virtually everything would have gone by ship down through a railroad to Panama, into New Orleans, or up through the East Coast. That is far and away the cheapest route. And as it turned out, because of the way railroads run, I won't bore you with the details, it is nearly as quick as putting it on a railroad car. Because once you send a railroad car from San Francisco and you head it east, God knows where it's gone. I mean, they have a hard time tracking these things. And it can take a very long time before you find that railroad car again.
So James J. Hill did not do it very differently from the others.
Though his timing's better.
But you also suggest that other countries did it differently, not necessarily Mexico and Canada, which, as you argue, are part of the continental transportation system, and everybody was embedded with everybody else. But you do allude to the fact, without really developing the point, that the Europeans did it differently. They built their major railroad transportation systems on a different model.
Yeah.
How different were they? Were they something that this country should have emulated?
Well, people said that we should do it, but it was too late. The cat was out of the bag. And the techniques they had were really simple. I mean, many of the problems that happened in the United States did not happen in France, did not happen in Germany, did not happen in England. Each one did it a little differently. What the English did is something really simple. If you are going to build a railroad, you have to put your own money in it. There has to be stock that's actually bought and paid for. And then most English railroads, the capital is raised by selling stock. There's actually stock at risk in the railroad. Most American railroads are not built that way. American railroads are built with bonds. They're all built with borrowed money. Americans try to control railroads by regulating the rates. The French are much smarter. The French say that you're always going to have rate problems. You're always going to have rate wars. You're always going to have pools. And you're always going to have corruption internally if we allow you to build a railroad any place you choose. So what the railroads say is the routes have to be approved by the state. And what they don't allow is what kills railroads in the West is these endless competitive routes without enough traffic to support them. So the French do it that way. What the Germans do is have much more state control. Each does it in a different way. And to be fair, they don't face the same problem the United States does. France, England, and Germany are relatively small countries. The United States has this vast area. And at the time of the 19th century, France, England, and Germany had far more capital than the United States did. We were a poor nation, capital poor nation, though we're certainly growing to be a rich nation very, very fast. We have to borrow a lot of the money that comes in. But if you compare railroads in the 19th century, as historians have done, several have done it, and the United States doesn't come off by any statistical measure, we don't come off that well. We have our low rates are largely because we carry cheap commodities very long distances, and so it's not so much the total rate, the total fare is low, but rates per mile are low because we carry them so many miles.
You also write a lot in the book, quite substantially, about not just the managers and their mismanagement, but also about the workers and the especially the confrontation between the American Railway Union and the management of the nationwide railway system in the 1890s. In what way, on the labor side of the dimension here, do we see a template for modernity, the way you argue we see it on the business and financial side?
Well, in some ways, we don't. I mean, one of the interesting things that was going back is I discovered something which historians tend to ignore, because what we do is we divide it up between labor unions, populists, greenbackers, and at the time, people called it something much simpler, anti-monopolism. There's a strong anti-monopolist wing in the Republican Party, a strong anti-monopolist wing in the Democratic Party. The third parties are all anti-monopolists. There's worker anti-monopolism. What they mean by monopoly is corporation. Pretty much they use the words synonymously. And the reason they dislike corporations is they think control is being taken away from ordinary people. And I began to realize that in the 19th century, there's something which is not modern in the sense that it's vanished from current politics. If it's here, I haven't seen it. It's that Americans in the 19th century, not all of them, but I'd say a majority, that's why the reforms work, believe that the purpose of an economy in a Republican society is to produce Republican citizens. It's not to produce the highest gross national product. Instead, what they say is it should produce citizens who are able to take their civic role in the Republic, and they're very clear on what they're talking about here. That means a worker should be able to support a family, that there should be a kind of independence among producers. Nobody can dictate to them about the conditions in which they will reach market. They really hold these things very, very seriously, and it becomes the core of this politics. It's a politics I think we utterly misunderstand now, but they understood very well at the time. So the unions I look at, the Knights of Labor is not a modern labor union. The Knights of Labor, businessmen join it, lawyers join it, all kinds of people join it. Instead, what they see themselves is taking Republican ideals, small R Republican ideals, and bringing them over into the economy, that they thought the economy should be subservient to the Republic and not vice versa, that it wasn't the government's job to serve business, but the business should produce certain kinds of citizens so the American Republic would survive. And that way, it's very Lincolnian. They see the country as largely made up of middling people. The problem they have is two things. They define these things in terms of manhood. If by manhood, they mean white manhood. Most anti-monopolists are racist to the core. This really is about white manhood. And it's also about men. It's about the ability of men to support a family. It's about women being domestic, being in the home. So there's real limits to this. It is not the kind of thing you bring over into the late 20th century. But to me, it was another one of those revealing points. I'm looking at a different way of seeing the world. Americans in the late 19th century are not like us. They thought of the world in a very, very different way. And once you understand that, the politics become much more comprehensible.
I just want to dwell for a minute. I think I'd be remiss if I didn't. On one of the stylistic properties of this book, it's not merely a deeply researched and compellingly told analytic and narrative history. But you sprinkle through the book, I'm not sure quite what to call them, elements that reminded me of the way John Dos Passos put together so many different elements in that famous USA trilogy. You call yours railroad life or railroad lives and mise-en-scène, which are just these little vignette-ish passages that are scattered through the narrative itself. How did you come to the conclusion that you wanted to put that kind of thing in there? And what is the purpose that it's intended to serve for the reader?
Yeah, I mean, the Dos Passos analogy is dead on. This is what's so embarrassing. This is why, in fact, authors should never be allowed to give an account of what they did. David said it to me today. He said it sounded a lot like John Dos Passos. And I said, oh, yeah, that's where I got it from. Because I used to love John Dos Passos as a teenager. Writing them, John Dos Passos did not cross my mind. But clearly, lurking back there some way was this. And I do it probably for the same reasons Dos Passos did. This is a big narrative. What I wanted to do is bring it down to daily life. What I wanted to do is bring it down to not just the associates, Henry Villard, Charles Francis Adams, big corporations, but how the railroad transforms people in their daily life. And like any historian, I also found stuff in the archives that was just too good not to use. And these had nothing to do with the main line, though they have everything to do with the main line. Because the trick is, in all the mise-en-scene, all of the railroad lives, is to show how working out in this really nitty-gritty way are the bigger themes that I'm talking about. Now, you know, I'll give you an example. I ran across a series of scattered correspondence about it. A young woman named Joanna Grogan, who was run over by Collis P. Huntington's railroad train. And Collis P. Huntington, I mean, railroad work was incredibly dangerous in the 19th century. I mean, every year, more workers are killed than were killed in the Civil War Battle of Shiloh. Every year, year after year. Huntington's workers died in their tens, hundreds, and more. But most of the time, that never enters his correspondence. Joanna Grogan got to him. So there's a lot of stuff that's written about her. And what it turns out is one statistic grabbed me. Joanna Grogan made a dollar a day. She worked as a maid in a hotel in a town in Missouri. By the time they were done with the hospital bills, she died. She had to have her leg amputated by very incompetent doctors. Her hospital bill amounted to about 2 years of her work. She would have had to work 2 years to simply pay the bill for the hospital. Huntington doesn't want to pay the bill, though he's offered to, because he realizes he's being cheated by all of the local people, the hotel keeper, the undertaker, and all the doctors. And he is being cheated. What they see this is they see Joanna Grogan as a chance to make some money off of an accident. But what they've done is they've taken on somebody who cheats on such a colossal scale, they have no idea what they've gotten in with. You're not going to cheat Collis P. Huntington. And what he does do is he breaks them all down. They all have to settle for much less or get nothing at all. He buys out Joanna Grogan's father's farm's mortgage. Joanna Grogan's father had five children. None of them had shoes. But there's a final detail that comes in there, too. Where did the mortgage come from? And this is a typical Gilded Age story. The mortgage came from the county clerk who had embezzled the school fund and then loaned it out to local farmers for mortgages. So at this point, I thought, you know, from bottom to top, no wonder Mark Twain called it the Gilded Age. I mean, every place you scratch, you find these kinds of stories. I later found there are plenty of honest people in the 19th century, not very many in the railroad archives, but plenty of people in the 19th century.
Well, we've come to the point in our program where there's time for only one last question. I'm afraid it's a kind of a big question. I'm going to paraphrase several versions of it that have come up from members of the audience. But one standard narrative of the Transcontinental Railroad is that it's the first installment in a series of federal investments in the development of the American West, nation building, federal nation building in the West, that extends through not from the Transcontinental Railroads themselves, heavily federally subsidized, through the great hydro projects of the early and middle 20th century, Hoover Dam, Shasta Dam, Grand Coulee Dam, so on, the Interstate Highway Act of the 1950s, and now the federal subsidies for high-speed rail in the California corridor. So some people would argue that there's a direct genealogy here, and all of these things are part of a long-running historical project to invest in the kind of communication, transportation, and energy-producing infrastructure that has made this region. So to the extent that that's the story, you're arguing that, in fact, the initial step in this process was badly misplaced and mistimed. So should we extrapolate from that to critical judgments about the later installations of this same general strategy, the hydro projects, the interstate highway system, and something I know you've opined about in the pages of the New York Times recently, high-speed rail?
Okay, I should make my position as clear as I can in 2 minutes. I'm clearly opposed to high-speed rail because I see it as, I won't even go into it, but I just say that I see that as much more like the Transcontinentals than not like the Transcontinentals. But I'm not against federal infrastructure investment. All I ask is that you do two things. First of all, when you build something, you think about the consequences of building it, and you think if it's needed now. Much of the problems with the Transcontinental Railroads is they're built way ahead of demand. By the time, in fact, you need those railroads, they would have decayed into rust. There's a kind of sense, well, we built it now, but we'll use it later. Think about your house. You don't build your house and move into it 40 years later because there's going to be no house to move into. You have to keep pouring money into it to keep it up. Once you build these things, they become this constant demand to money pours into them. So if you build them ahead of demand when you don't need them, it is going to be extraordinarily costly. My argument about the railroads is most of the railroads up to about the 100th meridian would have been built without federal subsidies. They would have been built anyway. Railroads in California would have been built without federal subsidies. They would have drained into San Francisco Bay. The subsidies are really needed in between the 100th meridian and the Sierras. And my question is, well, did you need it then? Why then? Why do you need so many of them? What are the costs of having done it? I've written a book on the Columbia River, The Organic Machine. Organic Machine was, again, about building dams, federal subsidies. But things turn out differently. In the dams, the United States got incredibly lucky. The critics were exactly right. They said, what are you building? What are you going to do with this electricity? Is it for jackrabbits? We have a farm surplus. Why are you going to irrigate more land when you're trying to get people to abandon land and not plant? And those were perfectly rational arguments. What happened, of course, was World War II. An utterly, for historians, contingent event. It had nothing to do with the building of the dams. Suddenly, you needed all of that electricity. You needed it for Hanford. And in fact, you needed as much food as you could produce. Now, that might be great planning on somebody's part, but really, it was just sheer luck. I mean, sometimes you're just bailed out. But it's best to not count on being bailed out. It's best to be cautious about these things. So my argument is not against subsidies per se, but again, against this kind of dumb growth, to think about what we're subsidizing and why, because people can give you all the arguments for the Transcontinentals were wonderfully plausible and ended up not being true.
Well, our thanks to Richard White, professor of history at Stanford University and co-director at the Bill Lane Center for the American West, and most importantly for our purposes here this evening, the author of the new book, Railroaded, The Transcontinentals and the Making of Modern America. And I can assure you it's a book that both entertains and provokes on virtually every page. We also thank our audiences here and on radio, television, and the internet. And tonight's program has been held in association with the California Historical Society. I'm Professor David Kennedy from Stanford, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know, is adjourned.